Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this plenary session on Europe's twin challenges. Europe is always facing challenges. Today they are twin challenges. And I was saying to our distinguished panel a few minutes ago that even these twin challenges, each of them has several grandchildren. And so we'll be well challenged today in being able to address them all in the time that we have. But we are very fortunate to have with us a very distinguished panel, which I will introduce very quickly. Sigmar Gabriel, the Vice-Chancellor and Federal Minister for Economy and Energy of Germany. We have Laimdota Straujuma, the Prime Minister of Latvia, Enda Kenny, the Taoiseach of Ireland. We have Alexander Stubb, Prime Minister of Finland, and Mark Rutte, Prime Minister of the Netherlands. And we are going to jump into the big agenda at the moment of a Europe that is not just facing the challenges of growth, which continues, as you all know, to be, at least in aggregate, depressed, slow across the Eurozone and across the EU as a whole, even though there are some standout countries, and a couple of them on this panel, in terms of the growth pattern at least. But it's also a Europe that is facing challenges of stability, and the stability is both internal, in terms of challenges to established political parties and structures, the challenge of terrorism, so tragically shown in the attacks in Paris recently, and the stability of a neighborhood that probably has never been quite as turbulent in recent decades as it is today, both to the east and to the south. And inevitably, that external instability is projecting itself internally inside each of these countries, inside the EU as a whole. So it is a big agenda, and these are a very dramatic and difficult set of twin challenges. Let me start, first of all, with Sigmar Gabriel, and I'm going to kind of run it this way. I'm going to run it in alphabetical order. So Sigmar Gabriel first. And maybe this is an inevitable question to give to you today on the day where at some point in the middle of this panel, we're likely to hear something at least about European quantitative easing. Have we reached an inflection point 5 years at least after the height of the crisis, the financial crisis, where Europe does not seem to be able to get a kickstart to growth through the structural reforms that everyone has undertaken so painfully in their labor markets, in all sorts of aspects of their domestic economies. But this is a time where stimulus of some sort is needed in a more active and proactive way to be able to get Europe back to a sustainable growth pattern. And I might just say that Sigmar Gabriel will answer in German if he wishes. I'll let him make his choice, but you all have the translation devices with you.
Now, I beg your pardon, because I think I was too engaged in politics as a young man and not a very good student for English and French, so thanks a lot for giving me the opportunity to answer in German. Unsere Erfahrung in Deutschland
with the necessary structural reforms
ist ja auch gewesen, dass es lange gedauert hat, bis wir uns entschlossen hatten,
it took us a long time to
sie durchzuführen.
The decision to actually implement
Zweitens, sie haben
and then secondly,
zu erheblichen innenpolitischen Verwerfungen geführt.
They led to much
und drittens,
internal political
wir ernten
discussion and
Erfolge der Strukturreformen 8 bis 10 Jahre
and
danach.
And we're reaping the fruits of this reform only 8 to 10
Warum
years
sollte
after
das
having
in Europa
introduced
anders sein?
Them. So why should this be different for
Erstens,
Europe?
Viele Länder tun sich schwer,
First of all,
solche
many
Entscheidungen
countries
zu treffen.
Have a hard time taking such
Und ich würde
decisions.
Als Deutscher sagen,
and as a German, I would
manche Strukturreformen,
say
die jetzt zum Beispiel in Frankreich, in Italien notwendig sind, oder die Griechen längst in Angriff nehmen mussten, sind weit, weit härter als die, die wir uns als Deutsche zugemutet haben. Das gehört, glaube ich, auch zur Wahrheit. Das Zweite ist, ich glaube, dass
secondly, die europäische Politik I also believe that on the whole European politics
der Europäischen
and
Zentralbank
policies,
die Aufgabe, Wachstum und Beschäftigung
ECB
zu stimulieren, nicht alleine überlassen
and
darf.
And
deswegen ist die deutsche Bundesregierung jedenfalls der Überzeugung, dass das Programm, das die Europäische Kommission und der Kommissionspräsident Juncker vorgeschlagen hat, jedenfalls die Chance beinhaltet,
at least bears in it the opportunity
of
combining structural reform and growth initiatives and incentives. But the structural reforms will also have to be taken into account and actually take place. They should not be neglected. And the growth initiatives should not just be a straw fire, an economic straw fire, but actually invest in the competitivity
Forschung und Entwicklung,
of Europe, in research and development, in energy efficiency,
vielleicht
in
nur als letzte Bemerkung
progress.
Zur deutschen Erfahrung. 2003 gab es zwei Länder, die die Maastricht-Kriterien der Verschuldung nicht eingehalten haben. Das eine Land war Deutschland, das andere Frankreich. Aber zwischen beiden Ländern gibt es einen riesigen Unterschied. 2003 war das Jahr, in dem wir in Deutschland unsere Struktur
was the year Germany started its structural reforms and we knew
diese Strukturreform
that
mit Investitionen verbinden müssen.
We would need to
deshalb
also
haben wir die Maastricht-Kriterien nicht eingehalten.
At the same time
hätten wir sie einhalten müssen, hätten wir zusätzlich 20 Milliarden Euro einsparen müssen.
We,
meine Prognose ist, der Widerstand
20
in Deutschland wäre so groß geworden, es wäre gar nicht zur Strukturreform gekommen.
Would have been so strong
Frankreich
that we wouldn't have had any
hat lediglich mehr Schulden gemacht.
But at the time, France simply increased its debt, didn't have any structural reforms,
meine Erfahrung daraus,
didn't attack them and introduce them.
Ist, and my conclusion from that is that such reforms mit Investitionen
always
in die
have to be combined
in, Bildung,
in investment
in
education, development, research, competitivity,
werden.
And
das eine
have to be connected to
andere.
Growth. You cannot do one without the other.
If I could just come back very quickly on one point, Germany obviously benefited, however, at its time of doing structural reform, you might say, from the fact that other countries did not do it at the same time. Therefore, the rest of the EU remained a stimulated, active market that you were able to then deploy your more efficient economy into. Whereas today, obviously, throughout the EU, people are undertaking structural reform, and Germany itself is continuing a fairly tight policy of looking for a zero budget deficit, cutting its overall debt level. So surely you benefited in Germany from an imbalance, you might say, at that time. But now all of the Eurozone is having to work pretty much to one hymn tune, to one one set of options.
Die Aufgabe Deutschlands ist natürlich jetzt,
the task for Germany now,
auch durch seine
today,
eigene Politik, auch durch seine eigenen Investitionen in die Infrastruktur,
its own policies and its own structural reforms, its
den Versuch
own
der Europäischen Kommission, ein Stimulus-Package auf den Weg zu bringen, zu unterstützen, das werden wir auch tun.
To support the EU and the Commission when it brings onto the market,
muss jede Regierung und jede Nation
stability
natürlich
package,
selbst schaffen.
But every nation
den
has
Mut
to
aufbringen zu solchen
have the courage to broach such structural reforms and to speak clearly about them without making people afraid.
Gesehen, Länder,
this is difficult.
Haben,
the countries that have attempted this
in der Regierung damit bezahlt haben, dass sie hinterher
usually
bei der nächsten Wahl
have had to pay with not being elected next time round.
Ja auch zur Wahrheit.
They lost
trotzdem,
to the opposition. That's also part
so.
Of the truth.
We,
that was our experience.
Diese Strukturreform in Gang gesetzt und
the Social Democrats
dafür
launched the structural
Preis
reform
bezahlt.
And
trotzdem,
then we paid a heavy price for it, but there is no alternative.
Die Alternative ist, dass man
the alternative
die Krise verlängert
would be to prolong
und
es
am Ende für die Menschen immer schwieriger wird.
And that the situation becomes untenable
aus,
for human beings.
Andere, Schreibtisch vielleicht noch viel mehr zu beitragen. Wir haben gerade über Irland gesprochen. Wie schafft man es, Menschen die Zuversicht zu geben, dass sie trotz schwieriger Zeiten am Ende davon profitieren werden? Das finde ich eine der wichtigsten politischen Führungsaufgaben, den Menschen diese Zuversicht nicht zu nehmen, sondern im Gegenteil, ihnen zu sagen, das ist die Voraussetzung dafür, dass es euch und euren Kindern besser geht. Und wir haben einige Kollegen hier, die mit dieser Aufgabe jeden Tag immer noch konfrontiert sind und damit, wie ich finde, ziemlich großen Erfolg haben.
Thank you very much for those replies. Let me turn to Enda Kenny. We were again saying before we came on stage here, this is a Northern European panel, and yet within it there is actually huge diversity in economic performance. I said earlier that the Eurozone is roughly in a fairly flat economic picture, but that wouldn't be the case for Ireland, where I think your growth rate is over 4% at the moment and looking to hold, you know, maybe a 3.5% in the next few years. However, unlike some of the other countries represented on this panel, you're carrying a heavy debt burden, a fairly fragile recovery. Where do you see this balance between the structural reforms that you've undertaken and the need for a more accommodating economic environment across the board within Ireland?
I think I should give you some context here. The government I lead was elected in 2011. At that stage, we had unemployment was over 15%. We were blocked out of all the international markets. We'd lost our credibility and integrity. We entered a bailout program, 64 billion, with no tools at the European level to deal with that, for a population of 4.5 million, with just 2 million people working, lost 250,000 jobs. So when you speak of stability, I think it's important to note this. The government I lead is comprised of two parties, a centre-centre-right party and a left-of-centre party. And we were able to maintain political stability in the country despite the unprecedented economic circumstances that we inherited. And that was because we were able to set out a very clear plan, a very clear strategy, to explain to people that the challenges that we all face as a country were unprecedented. And it meant that instead of choosing a path of confrontation, we actually chose a path of constructive negotiation with the Troika and with the European institutions. And if that's of any value in terms of stability, we're now at a point where just a fortnight ago you were able to borrow 10-year money at less than at 0.86% and able to buy out over the next or this year and last year the IMF loans that were borrowed at much higher rates. But if there's any lesson in that, it is that European countries have got to work closer as Europeans and with the institutions, of which the ECB is one, the European Council and the European Commission. The Commission is a new Commission. It set out platforms for investment, for structural change, and for stable public finances. Because we cannot continue with a Europe where there's a chasm of disconnection between the Commission, the Council, and the individual governments. And if you don't do that, it leads to extremism on either side, which causes social disruption and political instability. So for us, having learned a difficult lesson here, our recovery is fragile and it's incomplete. We need another 3 to 5 years of steady growth and of political stability, negotiating with our European colleagues so that the people of our country actually feel the benefit of a recovery. So we're in a different spot, but it's fragile and incomplete. And I can see the lines up ahead where we as our country and as all other countries actually need to work much closer together with the institutions that the treaty set up to deliver prosperity, hope, opportunity and jobs for our people.
And just quickly on debt, because you've got this high level of growth at the moment. Your deficit has come down extensively, but you're pulling down a debt level that was in the 120% ratio to GDP. Yes. You know, is this like the millstone around Ireland's neck, if you see what I'm saying? Is this going to be manageable over time?
It's part of the difficulty, but our debt has peaked at 123%. It's now down just above European levels. It will continue to fall rapidly. We had a deficit in double digits 3.5 years ago. It will be below 3% this year. It will be eliminated by 2018. And we expect on the growth pattern that we've got now on the plan and the strategy that we're following to be able to create what we call full employment by 2018. That is the recovery of all of the 250,000 jobs that were lost during the economic collapse, to have that restored. And that means, in terms of politics being about people, that young people who left Ireland as immigrants will be able to come home and work in their own country, if that's their choice, with new experiences and new skills. So I actually see the time ahead, while it's difficult and challenging, and there are extraneous issues like Russia and energy costs and all that that can impact on a country. The weakening of the euro has been of great benefit to Ireland in terms of exports and in terms of what we offer from tourism and so on. So I'm very optimistic for the time ahead, but it does require not just clarity of agenda, but discipline in managing public finances, in making those difficult political changes in individual countries, and collectively working with the institutions that we are to work with for a population of 500 million people. We should not be in a position where there's this chasm of disconnect between the institutions and the citizens, because Europe offers, and I want it to be a place where they can have that hope and aspiration and belief that it offers opportunity for children of the next generation, for every country.
Thank you. Let me turn to Mark Rutte. Mark, the Dutch economy performed actually pretty well through the crisis, and yet we're hitting a period now where growth in the Netherlands is really headed down to a pretty modest, 1%-ish kind of level. And I'm just wondering whether, from your perspective, having been one of the countries that was held up as one of the ones that actually performed quite well through the crisis, what do you think is driving this slowdown that you're experiencing at the moment in terms of external performance? And the current account remains very strong, 7.5% of GDP or so, and yet you're stuck at the moment in terms of the growth side. What does this tell us about the broader picture for Europe and its future picture of a country like the Netherlands, which is so competitive internationally, is struggling domestically?
Well, my assessment of the Netherlands situation is a bit different. I would argue that we were hit quite badly at the start of the crisis in 2008, 2009, being an exporting country. We were hit quite hard by the situation, and it was bringing our growth figures down and our unemployment up. We were basically lagging behind in Europe, and at the moment we have modest growth figures of over 1.5%, and we are now at the forefront of the European growth expectations. And what we have done is basically applied the basic recipe, which I believe you almost always have to apply in times of crisis, which is to work on fiscal consolidation, getting your public finances in order, as Enda was saying, at the same time making sure that you take care of all the necessary reforms. And we have reformed the housing market, the health sector, the social security sector, pensions, education, everywhere. And at the same time, continue with investments in terms of research and development, and, for example, logistics. And we invested last year the biggest amount ever in our roads and our railways, over 8 billion euros. And some external experts are telling us that we now have the best road and railway system in Western Europe. And this will also drive growth, as my belief, over the time to come. And this goes back to the main challenge we are facing as a collective, because Europe at the moment is simply not competitive. And we have many imbalances. And my big worry is that we will slow down in Europe in terms of fiscal consolidation and reforms, while we have to step up in terms of fiscal consolidation and reforms. And Ireland, but also Portugal, and even Greece is a case in point, that when you do this, when you take care of all these necessary measures, that at the end, you will see growth returning. and unemployment falling and house prices rising again. So this is your evidence.
That, as you said, that optimistic outlook is one that's there. But how vulnerable do you think Europe is at this moment of adjustment, where it's right, as you said, in the middle still of a lengthy structural adjustment to be competitive in the world? How vulnerable then is Europe to external shocks? Let me hold off on Russia and Middle East. We'll cover those in the middle. But I'm thinking of, in a minute, I'm thinking about China, decreased growth there, whether export markets, we need a very benign international environment in order to enable this structural period to be undertaken. Would you share that element of caution?
We are extremely vulnerable, and this is because we take too much time to implement the necessary measures. And this is a painful process, and when you go through a painful process, make it as short as possible, like the Irish did, like they do in Portugal and in Greece. Make it as short as possible, but we take so much time, and some of our biggest economies are still debating some of the necessity of this recipe. And if we are not applying it, my worry is that we will stay at a relatively low competitive level, that we will be, as you asked me, quite that we will run the risk that what is happening in China and other parts of the world will hit our economy much more than is necessary.
Yeah.
So my plea is that we step up the game, and I'm absolutely convinced that our general public will understand this. Mm-hmm. The fact that now a number of governments which have implemented, like my own, this recipe have been re-elected is also a case in point.
Prime Minister Straujuma, if I can turn to you now, a country that's demonstrated in Latvia some very impressive growth levels, 3% range, still quite low debt, so positive in that sense, but unemployment quite high, obviously hit also in the crisis. Could you share a thought or two about how you are adjusting, but also given that you're Latvia is president of the EU at the moment. You're obviously therefore very much involved in the EU agenda. How do you see the EU agenda supporting what you're trying to achieve domestically in Latvia at the same time?
In the beginning, I want to say about growth and stability. And if we speak about growth and stability, then growth, economic growth, is a must for stability. It's a must, and stable growth will be our archangel for Europe. If we speak about Latvian crisis and how Latvia overcame crisis, we had, in the beginning, we had huge consolidation of budget, and two-thirds of our consolidation came from structural reforms, and one-third we increased VAT for 4 points. And what we did, what is main, how to say, main issues, speed of decisions, then ownership. It is, our reform was drafted in Latvia. It is our own reform. Then it is solidarity. We sit in one room, all parties, trade unions, business, municipalities, coalition parties, and all of these groups signed agreement that we agree with consolidation, with our structural reforms. And it's
working.
Good result. It's good result. And now we have growth, but I agree what Mark said. We had to do all these things in one time. Mm-hmm. Improving export. We had now growing exports. And we had a social security pillow for unemployment because unemployment was increased at that time. Now it is in the same level as we had before crisis. So all these things in one time. And fast doing. And about Europe.
Yeah, how do you see the EU agenda EU, helping you in this process?
Very shortly, we have three priorities: competitive Europe, digital Europe, and engaged Europe. And if we speak about competitiveness, then I want to again split in two parts. Besides structural reforms, it is something as necessity, number one. But it is investment plan, so-called Juncker's investment plan, what we want to push through all legislation regulations in our presidency and start implement new investments, then international trade, TTIP, yeah, free trade agreement with USA, Japan, Canada, we need exports of our trade. But it will be not easy because we have to transparency and explain to society why it will benefit for EU. Yeah, investment plan.
It sounds like a good plan. Let me turn to Alexander Stubb now. Again, Finland at the moment finding growth very difficult to deliver, particularly hit probably on the external side at the moment.
Yeah.
Where would you place this balance right now? Where do you see Finland in the flow between structural reform starting to show returns and the need for a more accommodating environment within the EU as a whole?
It's probably a balance between the two. Just two quick comments. The first one is I think we should, as the public sector or politicians, stop creating an illusion that it is the public sector that drives growth and jobs. It is not. It's the private sector that does it. There is no growth without entrepreneurship. There is no growth without companies that actually create value added. What us, the public sector, can do is basically on three things on three levels. Number one is structural change at home. We're all grappling with that. I agree with Laimdota, I agree with Mark, that you have to do things as soon as the crisis hits. The problem we had in Finland, we probably did too little, too late. The second level is the European level. There we must continue to liberalize the single market, cut red tape, and basically create a digital single market. We have not completed the single market yet. There is not sufficient free movement of goods, labor, services, and money, and we have to keep on working on that against all the protectionist tendencies that we have right now. And the third thing that we can do is liberalize world trade. Again, I agree with Laimdota and with Enda. We need a TTIP, EU-US free trade agreement. We need to push in that direction. My second comment is on the stimulation of economies. I divide it into two, quite simply. One is public money stimulus. I think we've come to the end of the road on that one. Finland pumped in probably more per capita than anyone else in 2009, 2010, 2011. Subsequently, we doubled our debt from approximately 50 billion to 100 billion. So we've gone from 30% of debt ratio to GDP now up to 60, and yet we have low growth figures. I do not think that you can stimulate an economy on the basis of debt. That runs into trouble at the end of the day. The other side of it is then what the ECB does. And of course, I firmly believe in the independence of the ECB. Whatever they do on quantitative easing today, we welcome with a smile.
So you're neutral, but you welcome it with a smile. So that's not a frown. So I will interpret something at least into that. But let me ask you one thing, because of course the other big thing happening this week will be the vote in Greece.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, given what we've heard across this panel, countries that were hit very hard by the crisis, that have had to take, as you said, one hit structural reforms, and other countries that took structural reforms earlier and parties lost power, how much sympathy would there be amongst a group of this sort of leaders for, if there were a Syriza government, a demand for a renegotiation of some sort of the debt burden that's been carried? I'm thinking Enda Kenny, Ireland carrying 123 down to 100, you know, chipping away at that debt burden. But Finland as well, just if I could start with you, Alexander Stubb, that, as you said, pumped in a lot of money, is now having to take very painful reforms domestically. How much sympathy is there going to be politically? How much room for maneuver is there to negotiate with a government that just wants a different option?
I think there's been a lot of sympathy and a lot of solidarity throughout Europe. I think Mr. Gabriel put it quite well. We needed to have that. We've taken extensive measures to try to stabilize the Eurozone. Portugal came back on the market. Ireland has come back on the market. Greece is trying to come back on the market. All of us have taken very difficult structural reforms. I can't take issue with the Greek elections. All I can say is that I should, in the name of fairness, tell the Finnish electorate and the Greek electorate what the Finnish position is. And the Finnish position is that we'll deal with any democratically elected government that Greece has, and that it will be very difficult for us to forgive any loans or restructure debt at this particular moment. Mm-hmm. We can look at different kinds of extensions, we can look at different kinds of programs, and we will deal with it. I think we're looking at three different scenarios. One is that things will continue as are. Two is that we'll go into an extensive period of instability in renegotiating something, not renegotiating the debt levels, but something with the structural programs. And then three, a dirty exit. And I think we need to try to avoid the dirty exit at all costs. But as I said, we respect the democratically elected government in Greece.
Yep. Sir Gabriel, if I could come back to you quickly on one of the kind of drivers that was put out there potentially of growth, which is, laid out TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. I think in Germany in particular, there are real reservations about certain aspects of that agreement. And yet it is held up, amongst other steps, as one of those sort of not deficit-increasing options that Western economies have to try to improve their competitiveness, size of the market, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, are you supportive of the TTIP aims? Do we have to break it into pieces? What's your sense of the timing? Just very quickly, I know it's a very difficult debate in Germany, but where do you stand on this?
It's a difficult debate in Germany, but also in France, in Austria and some other countries.
UK.
Maybe in Germany, sometimes it's more difficult because we are a country which is rich and hysteric. This combination is sometimes difficult. Please do not read it. Bring it to the newspapers.
I'm sure they won't.
We are among us and among friends, so we can speak very open and frank. No, come to the point. I mean, I think what's necessary is that we all in Europe should bring the debate about free trade agreements on a different level, on a higher level. Because, of course, it's necessary to negotiate many different issues. And some of them are difficult to come to a common agreement for the time being. But in my country, and I think also in some others, it's necessary to explain to the citizens why we are negotiating about a free trade agreement with the US. And therefore, we have to show that the guys from China and others, they call the 21st century a Pacific century, but in reality, they mean an Asian century. Uh-huh. And of course it is an Asian and a Pacific century. And if when I looked some weeks ago to this Asian meeting, I thought by myself, my goodness, what kind of self-consciousness we can see there. And the last guy from Europe was Mr. Putin. Nobody else from us was there. So what I think is maybe it's the last chance for Europe to influence standards for world trade agreements. The next agreement will be one between the US and the Asian Pacific region. And whatever we have, which kind of questions we have to the standards, to stability, to social questions, to questions to the ecology and others, agreements about free trade between Asia and the US will have a different level to agreements between Europe and the US. And we should use maybe our last chance to set the standards. That's from my perspective the reason why we need these agreements. And it's necessary to bring the public debate on this level. Nevertheless, we have to solve at the same time a lot of questions. In the center, I think, is the debate about ISDS in my country. But I mean, we are able to send people to the moon why we should not be able to solve questions to ISDS and others. It is possible. And Europe, this is one of the biggest chances Europe has for the next decades, and we should use them.
I think if Germany is engaged in making the solution happen, then I suspect the solution would probably happen. Alexander Stubb, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, very quickly. I mean, it's very important that we make a case for TTIP. The problem is that it's one of these issues which sort of become like the Polish plumber of the services directive, because you can be anti-European, anti-American, anti-free trade, anti-national or multinational corporations, and you start sort of stirring around. ISDS, I mean, hands up who knew that letter combination a year and a half ago. I mean, I put it into books, ISDN, that's what I thought it was. There are over 5,000 investment protection agreements worldwide. There are approximately 500 cases on the basis of it. We've had a very close look at them, and as a matter of fact, most of them have ended up quite well. All of our free trade agreements have investment protection agreements. It's very important that we have one with the United States as well. It's just important that we consult, we find and iron out any kind of problems with it. But again, if we want to jolt into our economy, what better way of doing it than the two biggest economies in the world, the EU, which is the biggest economy in the world, and the US, do it together. And much like Mr. Gabriel said, it's a question of who wants to set the standards of free trade. Is it Europe and the US? Or is it China? That's the choice that Europe has.
Mark, you wanted to come in, but can I just piggyback on your next intervention by bringing in the populism issue? I mean, I laid this at the beginning. Part of political stability in Europe is that the political environment is much more febrile. From the big to the small countries, you have populist parties that are really gaining traction. They're gaining traction on the back of past foreign policy failures, on the global financial crisis. And then TTIP kind of fits into a conspiracy theory of globalization, Americanization. Can you just address this as well? Because you've got features of this in the Netherlands very much.
Well, that's where we as politicians come in. And we have to make sure that we make the case. The urgency to do this and the fact that TTIP, this free trade agreement, will, as you said, help to add growth to Europe without having to increase government spending. So this is a fantastic opportunity. And yes, we have to be extremely transparent and also to explain the negatives and the positives and the trade-offs, et cetera, et cetera. That's exactly what we are doing. But I wanted to expand on this because I fully agree with both speakers on TTIP. But there are more opportunities to add growth to Europe. And I feel the sense of urgency to do this without having to increase government spending. Some are already mentioned. The digital single market will add 3.8 million jobs. If we would really be effective in implementing the services directive, this would add 2.5, 2.6, maybe even 5% extra growth to Europe, which we are not doing at the moment. And then the energy market. If we would be really effective in implementing the energy market, that would also add extra growth and make us more energy independent. So there are ample opportunities, and I think the frustration sometimes, the sense of urgency, to put it more positively, I think we all feel, is that collectively in Europe we are not doing enough to bring this about.
Enda Kenny, on the issue of the services market and this idea that there are, if not politically, at least structurally low-hanging fruit that can be grasped at the moment, are you, as a government, trying to really push this within the EU context or not?
Absolutely. I can't disagree with the comments about TTIP and, indeed, Alex's comments in respect of what might happen when the people in Greece cast their votes. During our own presidency of the Union, agreement was had from the European Parliament that the TTIP negotiations could start. I think it's absolutely, you're absolutely spot on here, in that this is an opportunity to set down standards for world trade. Inside 5 years, certainly inside 10 years, the frontiers up ahead will have changed utterly with digital connection and global access at the push of a button. So the teams on both sides are actually very good teams. I think there are about 17 chapters left here. But the frustration for the politician, because your mandate is limited anyway by virtue of the people's choice, and you never know what that's going to be, that when political decisions are made, that they should be followed through quickly. Now, the triangle between the Commission, the Parliament, which is now a co-responsibility following the Lisbon Treaty, and the European Council, means that with the politicians, the leaders, make decisions and agree at the European Council, to actually have those implemented without a vast bureaucracy growing up around it, which strangles it from a red tape perspective, is one that's recognised by this Commission. Because President Juncker has appointed a number of vice presidents who have been former prime ministers, who should know that when you make a political decision, you shouldn't allow it to get lost and strangled in red tape. This, I think, is a frustration that everybody's felt around the European Council table. So, in Ireland, yes, we had to reduce drastically the extent of people working in the public service. You had to restrict and do a deal with all of the trade unions in respect of pay and cutbacks in pay and moratoriums on recruitment. These things are very difficult for people to take. But at the same time, you've got to use whatever little flexibility you have in referring to what Mark said about creativity, entrepreneurship, ingenuity, through the education system and young people, seeing new opportunities and giving vent to allow that to happen. That means you've got to be very pragmatic in the choices that politicians actually make. What can help growth? How can we help young people get into business? If it fails, start again. Where are the new markets? I see real opportunities arising from TTIP. And whatever else drives us, it is the fact that you can set down standards for the next 40 years in terms of world trade. This is the prize. And the other prize at the end of that are jobs. You have competitive countries, well-managed economies, and millions of jobs on the side of the Atlantic. In the next 10 years, the phenomenal growth in populations in Asia will speak for itself. And that weight of population and weight of decisions coming from there will create its own momentum. But for us, as along with the United States, two of the most developed entities on the planet, we should be able to sit down and agree on how trading relations can improve for the benefit of all the countries and therefore all the people. That's what it's all about.
Thank you. Look, I'm going to open it up in a minute to get some questions from the participants here in the room. But let me just turn back first to Laimdota Straujuma and at least start to broach the external issues, the stability around, yes? You're going to have some interesting moments in your presidency coming up, in particular vis-a-vis Russia. There are sanctions review meetings that will need to take place in March and July. Fighting seems to have flared up again, but the Russian government wants to find a way to follow up on the Minsk agreements. I mean, we're in a very difficult period here at the moment. It strikes me, at least, between an EU that is obviously very uncomfortable about this being the new status quo, yeah, a detached relationship with Russia. And yet it sees the reality of the decisions that have been made by the Russian government, what has happened on the ground, and the decisions that were taken in the past European Council meetings. So I know it's a big question. Latvia, a small country sitting on the border of the Russian Federation, but also holding the EU presidency. How are you going to manage just your two or three priorities for these next 6 to 9 months in managing this relationship?
I want that everybody of us will think, what will be day after? What will be day after? There will be destroyed economy in Ukraine, without social safety. We have to think all, Europe, Russia, Ukraine, what will be day after in the end? And
You mean that what will be the day after if things go wrong or stay being
in
bad?
In another time it will end. I don't know in how it will end, but what will be the day after the end? But if we speak about a situation, in this 21st of century, nobody can accept that in the middle of Europe, one country takes one part of another country and simply. It's not acceptable. And politically, we can't accept this. We had a discussion in our European Council meetings. It's not acceptable. And our choice is sanctions. We had no another choice because there are no another choice. And we, I think nobody of us is happy with sanctions. Nobody's happy. It is our common decision, what we did in December, that sanctions will be more or less. It will be depends on Minsk agreement.
Right.
What will be with Minsk agreement? And what we see now in Ukraine, there are fights. And we will see what we will discuss and how what we will decide in March when we come together. But if situation will be not better as it now, that I don't see that somebody of us will say, let's stop these sanctions. It will be not this case.
Well, let me just give, because I know a few people wanted to come in on this point. I want to, Mark Rutte, Alexander Stubb, and Mr. Gabriel in particular, just a quick comment, because I'm going to open up here, and you may get questions on this as well. But Mark Rutte first. You know, Netherlands had a very strong, actually, economic relationship, as have many EU members, with the Russian Federation. In your, and obviously now in a very different position, not least after the terrible tragedy that befell your citizens earlier last year, but as you look to the future, do you have a map from your government's perspective of what would change the situation in terms of loosening or tightening sanctions or keeping them as they are? Do you have a kind of mental map that's fairly simple? Minsk agreement will lift, otherwise it stays as it is for as long as it needs. What's your mental map?
Well, exactly as you said, Russia has interfered in eastern Ukraine, has taken Crimea, and the sanctions have been linked to these facts. I have to stress, not linked to MH17. The tragedy with MH17 is now independently, there's now an independent inquiry going on. We have to await the results. The sanctions have been linked to what happened in Crimea and the fact that they interfered in eastern Ukraine. So that means that Russia has to implement what we collectively agreed. And Europe was involved. The French president, the German chancellor are heavily involved in this whole process. And we all support them in their role. So what has to be implemented is what has been agreed in Minsk. And when you take a look at the actual situation, there is every evidence that Russia is still interfering. Mm-hmm. There's every evidence that potentially even new military material, people and tanks, etc., are coming into Russia, coming into eastern Ukraine. And the dividing line between the territory held by the Ukraine and the territory held by the separatists, that dividing line, which is also part of the Minsk protocol, mm-hmm. is again being violated at various stages and various points. So at this stage, I find it totally unacceptable to discuss a weakening of the sanctions. Russia has to do what is only acceptable for a country to do, which is to accept the independence and sovereignty of Ukraine. And then later on, I think we as European Union have to make it clear that we want a strong relationship from Europe with Ukraine. But we also have to make it clear that we find it only acceptable and logical, and also from history, that Ukraine will also build a relationship with Moscow and Russia. It should not be a zero-sum game that Ukraine has to make a choice only for Europe. Given the history, their place on the map, it's only logical in the long term that they will build a strong relationship with Europe and Russia. But that means after the Minsk protocol has been implemented and the separatists have stopped what they are doing and Ukraine has taken full control of its territory.
Alexander Stubb.
Yeah, I mean, funnily enough, I remember last year in Davos, we talked a little bit about the geopolitical risk of Maidan Square, not of Russian invasion. And probably none of us believed that the ramifications would be as far-reaching as they have been, because all of us were basically preparing for the Sochi Olympics this time last year. I think we've had basically three ramifications. Number one is geopolitical. I think we're coming to the end of an era, and that is the end of the end of the Cold War. For the past 25 years, we believed that Russia would integrate itself into Western institutions. We've done a lot of work in that direction as well. We've had partnership agreements with the EU and Russia, with partnership agreements between NATO and Russia. Russia joined the WTO. We all felt and believed that Russia would become a normal Western democracy. The answer is, after 25 years, it hasn't. The second ramification is security political. Power politics and spheres of interest are back in the European borders. They came back with the war in Georgia in 2008 and have now been extended. And we are in a situation whereby a large country has basically annexed an area of a sovereign and independent state and created a sphere of interest. We are in a situation whereby on the borders of Europe, we basically have six frozen conflicts right now. Nagorno-Karabakh, Transnistria, South Ossetia, Abkhazia, the Crimean Peninsula, and now potentially Eastern Ukraine. That is wrong. That is why the European Union has reacted, should have reacted, and will continue to react. Then we come to the third ramification, and that is economics. Now, make no mince about this. The Russian economy has not gone down because of the sanctions. The Russian economy is in a free fall because it was not able to modernize itself post-Cold War. It is still based on energy and gas. 50% of their state income is oil and gas exports. Name one Russian consumer good that you use. There are not too many. The Russian economy will retract 4-5% this year. The Russian ruble is in a spiral. Inflation 10%, and the price of oil yesterday $46 to the barrel. Is this in all of our interests? No, it is not. It is in our both security political interest and in our economic interest to make things normal again. The only way in which it can be done is for Russia to do it themselves. And I say this coming from a country that has 1,300 kilometers of border with Russia. That is more than anyone combined in the European Union. And I come from a country whereby Russia is our biggest trading partner together with Sweden and Germany. We need to solve this crisis, but the ball is in the Russian court. If they don't fulfill the Minsk agreement, the peace process, I don't think we're going to get out of this in the foreseeable future. And I think that's a travesty, both for Russia and the Western world.
Let me give one last comment, Sigmar Gabriel. I'm going to open it up just on the Russia issue. If you want to add anything to this, not least if you share their views, then you can say
yes. Of course, completely agree with the Prime Minister of Finland. The ball is in the field of Russia. Maybe the only thing we should think about is what our colleague from Latvia said: what we can offer for the day after, what we can offer. What's our offer to Russia? Maybe in a new idea of this modernization pact, which we thought that it's the right way for Russia, and where we are all set that they do not use it in a proper way. But nevertheless, I think the next step should be also the discussion among us, what can be an idea for a partnership after we solve the current problems. I mean, the way through, it's only through the Minsk Protocol. There is no alternative. And everybody of us wants to relieve the sanctions, but sanction to relieve means Russia has to move. To move to what they agreed. It's nothing which is in heaven. It's in the protocol. But I think, I mean, we discussed about TTIP 1 second ago. Next step in Europe can be a negotiation with Russia about free trade. It was Putin's idea to have a free trade zone between Lisbon and Vladivostok. I mean, it's not the in a different world than we are today, it would be a good idea. So that should be the next debate about us, to offer them a way out, because maybe he has now a population which thinks by, what is 86% that he's doing a good job. But at the end of the day, Clinton said, it's the economy, stupid. And the economy is going down. And it went down before the sanctions, before the sanctions. Okay. And that would be my idea to think about the day after.
Thank you very much. Look, let me take three questions, and Please wait for the microphone to get to you, say who you are. I'll take three or four questions now and we'll distribute them. We've got a break at 11:25. I can see a first hand went up right here in the middle. And I see one there. Yep.
Roland Rudd, Finsbury. I would just like to ask the panel, how should Europe deal with the insurgent populist parties, particularly those on the right, who often appear morally repugnant?
Okay, just hold that thought. Looks like a question. Where were you? I see a gentleman there. Can we get a microphone there, please? There. Keep your hand up, please. Sir, keep your hand up. Thank you. And I'm looking around for another, but if people are cautious, that's fine.
Ben Fazul in Deutsche Welle. In trying to convince the people that TTIP is a good thing, that structural reforms are good, why are you failing?
Okay. Any more questions? There's a lot going on in Europe. I'm looking. Have you got one? No? Over there? Down here? Okay, let's take those and let people digest. I've got lots more questions. The Middle East hasn't come up yet. So if I can just actually throw that one onto the list in a minute. But first of all, how to deal with populist parties. Where to start? Yeah, I thought there have been some true Finns and some not true Finns. No. Yeah, Alexander Stubb, to you first.
We have elections in Finland in 3 months. First observation, you mentioned only the far right. I don't actually think it's a question of far right or far left. They're general populist movements, and the way in which I divide them is localists and globalists. A lot of the populist movements are basically localist, and they have very different strands. You have some far-right tendencies, but one could argue that there are many left tendencies which are anti-establishment, anti-government, anti-politics, anti-whatever. I think they've come out with a force. You have, of course, Geert Wilders in the Netherlands. You have Front National in France. You have the True Finns. In Finland. But for me, they're not a traditional populist party. They have actually now, over the years, tried to make themselves very governmentable, if you will. They talk quite sensible stuff on economic policy. They talk quite sensible stuff on foreign policy. Where I fundamentally disagree with them is on European policy and immigration. How do you deal with them? There have been two different approaches. Finland, we have allowed for cooperation. We discuss with the true Finns. We have not isolated them. And I think it's worked quite well. In Sweden, a different path has been chosen. There is basically no communication or cooperation between the mainstream parties and Sverigedemokraterna. And just to make sure that there are no misunderstandings, I'm not comparing the true Finns with the Sverigedemokraterna. I'm saying that there are different kinds of strands. So I think embracing populism in dialogue is probably the right way to go about it. But when you start talking about values, when you start talking about law, I think there are some limits that should be set in this dialogue and in this discussion.
Marco, I know you wanted to come in on this. Just one observation from a study I saw done on the UK on this issue was the extent to which British political parties had in many ways kind of ceded local politics or a local presence in some cases to some of the more populist parties that emerged in very specific parts of the country. It wasn't across the whole country. So, you know, one way for, let's call them more established parties or mainstream parties to be engaged against them is to get re-engaged in a way, which may link a bit to the second question. But yeah. I'll let you say whatever you want.
Well, I have to be very clear. It's us, all of us, all politicians of the main parties, centre-right, centre-left, and in the centre, who have created these populists. We have not given answers to certain questions. We have made certain issues a taboo, which should not be debated. We have seen immigration coming into Europe for good reasons. But this has also given a raise to tensions in society. And we said, well, we should not debate those tensions. We should not debate those issues. And then we think it is strange that voters then go to populist parties. So the answer is that the main government parties, which have always taken responsibility to take tough decisions, to lead our societies, also in difficult times, that again, and that's exactly, I think, what at least these panelists are all doing, and many other politicians, that we provide the answers. That we tell the people, yes, it is necessary to accept fiscal consolidation, tough measures, tough reforms. Yes, there is a reason why there has been immigration, and yes, we have to look at it again and be very sensible in how we continue with this, how we apply our asylum rules in Europe, and how we deal with this. And there is good reason for that. And when we do this, we don't have to discuss with these populist parties. We are discussing directly with our own electorate and explaining to them that we have the answers to these issues, that we understand all the worries, all the fears, and all the aspirations, and that we want to answer them. That's what we need to do. No taboos, having an open and fair debate between us, the main parties, the main parties in government, and our own people.
And Kenny, you want to come in?
The gentleman asked the question down there, why have you failed, or why are you failing? It's not actually a question of having failed, it's a question of not having delivered. Because trust in the institutions and politics actually comes from delivery. So it's a case of when you set out with a strategy and a plan, have you got the capacity to deliver on it? And if you fail to do that, it's also easy for opposition politics anywhere to say, well, I'll do differently. You don't actually have to pay for that. We've got a different view here. The key here is democracy and people. And at the end of the day, I feel in a country, in Ireland now, where you have a rise of populism no more than in any other country, it is a case of, out of all this confusion, out of all of the offers that come from populist parties, the key for the future is discipline, is clarity, is stability of agenda, so that people can say, there's the record, this is what you have delivered, this is where the future is, rather than everybody crossing over with their own different views. Otherwise, it leans to extremism right and left. And when I had the privilege of being in Paris after the tragedies, when all of the leaders walked down that street, arm in arm, linked together, it was a demonstration of the why of the European Union, as distinct from the what of the European Union. And therein lies the key to the future, that when people elect their politicians on particular programmes, it is a case of being able to deliver, because the frustration builds and populism follows, and on the extremes of right and left, you can see that it's social disruption that applies. So for every politician, there is no time to lose. There's got to be absolute focus on what is achievable and what can be delivered effectively in the interests of the people. That's the starting point and the end point, because they ultimately are the masters.
So it's a form of re-establishing trust on that. Look, we've got 5 minutes left. I've got one question I definitely want to ask, and I didn't see any other hands going up. Oh, sorry, there's one question apparently in the corner over there. You're holding a microphone up, but nope. Yes, madam. Yeah, one question here, then I'm going to add mine on if yours isn't the question.
Mandeep Rai from the LSE. This is a question for Gabriel regarding Germany's view on the Maastricht Treaty and whether it would allow some of the rules to be broken so that countries can get involved more.
Sorry, so the last begin?
So whether it allows some of the rules to be broken so that people can some of the countries can integrate further.
Okay. I think it's going back. You mean when they broke the Maastricht Treaty back in the 19... Actually, I can't remember when he broke the 3%, which he did address in his remarks.
2003.
Yeah, 2003. Thank you. 2003. Whether those rules, does he regret having broken them now? I think he actually gave an answer to that earlier on. And there's a question just waiting. Let's take that question as well with this. And I'll add mine in. We need to finish in 4 minutes. Yep.
Paul Sheard from Standard & Poor's. I'd like to ask a related question, which is really about the architecture of the economic and monetary union. And do you see the architecture of a monetary union without fiscal union, fiscal rules, but without fiscal union and associated political union as being sustainable and desirable in the long term?
Okay, so let's finish up with three questions. The first, because mine is going to come in a minute. The first are for Sigmar Gabriel, which was the issue of whether you regret or not that flexibility that Germany and France took in 2003. Or maybe it's good because it's given more scope.
I think that was the question.
Whether he would allow Greece to break the rules.
Yeah, exactly. Would you allow Greece to break the rules? You can answer that question. And maybe you might want to touch a little bit on the architecture as well. I will let each of you, I'll take it in this order, say something about it. But I do want Alexander Stubb, having done a long time as foreign minister, to answer the question Are we in a phase of containment on the Middle East? Is the threat that's emerging from there, that's hitting our societies internally now, one that needs to be contained? Or do we need to engage as well, to use the phraseology of Prime Minister Straujuma? Is the Middle East a place we need to engage in, or is it one we're going to have to contain? You can mull on that while we come around the table.
May I give a short question to the last question of the gentleman? If the construction of the monetary union is the right way to solve the question, I would answer no. Of course we have to go further to a fiscal union and to a political union, but I think it's senseless to discuss this future construction without doing the daily work. And the daily work is that every government has to find a combination between structural reforms and investments in the competitiveness. From my perspective, it's not the question if governments have public spending or not, it's the question in which sector they invest, in research and development, in education.
If Greece is investing in education, infrastructure, would you give them more flexibility?
My advice would be, in the discussion with the Greek government, to go further on the track that we had agreed. The difference between the decision 2003 for France and Europe and Germany was it was agreed in Europe. And now we have an agreement with Greece, which is, I think, relatively fair, and I completely agree with the Prime Minister of Finland said, that the voters in Greece are free to vote. And afterwards, we have to have a fair discussion with them, but also with our own taxpayers and citizens. And so that's the three options you said. The last one is that which we don't want to choose. The first two ones maybe are the solution for the day after the election. Then I only want to add one answer to the question of what's about populists.
Yeah.
I think the answer from Mark Rutte and also from Alexander Stubb, the German said Stubb, that's not right. To have a fair discussion, an open discussion about everything, that's the real answer. But we as politicians, we should not forget that some of our elite dialogues among politicians and with people from the business sector are not the same debates they have on the street. When we said, yes, we have to open the markets, the service markets, the single market in Europe, everybody says, yes, that's right, of course, it's economically right. But please ask a worker in your harbor, which has to pay the rents for the houses and flats in Amsterdam or Hamburg, if his competitor comes from Portugal with a wage was impossible to live in Hamburg or Amsterdam. So what is the answer? Is the answer that competition is only by low wages? Then you will create uncertainty and you will help the populists. So I have not a perfect answer today, but we should be careful to think that the dialogues between elites in the economy sector or politician sector is the same discussion they have on the breakfast table. And sometimes in the past we did the wrong thing. We said better we should not discuss what they are discussing on the breakfast table, and now we have them on the street.
We're coming right up to the close of this panel, and I think I want, Alexander, I put a question to you, which is a very difficult and very big question. Do you have a sort of a one-line-ish, one-centre-ish sort of answer to that? With all of your distilled experience as Foreign Minister.
Your question was whether to contain or engage in the Middle East. In 20 seconds, I think we should engage. And the only way in which we can engage is to try to contain the geopolitical risk through dialogue. Right. If the Middle East crisis had been solved in the past 40 years, my 20 seconds will not provide the answer. I'm sorry.
But that's a fair answer. Look, thank you very much to all of our panelists, a super panel. We have to finish really on time. I can see people already waiting on the sides to get all of our distinguished guests to their next meeting. Thank you very much for attending, for some good questions, and a very strong hand for our panel.